So dear friends, that's the last but not the least of the panels of the day. And unfortunately, we have run a little bit over time. Mike Weber from Wells Fargo has to catch a flight. So we will have Mike go first and give us his collective wisdom condensed in 5-10 minutes. We also have James Yang from Maxim Group and Herman Hildan from Clarkson's Platou Securities. So three very well-known houses. We're grateful that the analysts came all the way over to be with us today in Athens. And without any further delay, I'll ask, if you don't mind, Mike to go first. Mike, two questions I'd like to ask you. Give us your rundown of which are the sectors that you're most optimistic or pessimistic about. And then give us what do you think about the investor attitudes in shipping today?
Thanks for having me. And again, apologies for having to run off here in a bit. But, would say we're most optimistic around LNG. I would consider that to be in consensus. I think most people are optimistic around LNG at this stage. I actually would expect rates to moderate at some point in the next quarter or two before kind of pushing higher, but you know the general theme is that as rates approach break even and beyond, risk premiums should narrow. Investors become less concerned with rollover risk and the cost of capitals. Cost of capital for most of the larger LNG names opens up, and you can see growth restart at companies like Gaslog. Golar is already growing, and TK LNG. I would say we're probably most out of consensus around tankers, and we're not long tankers by any stretch, but I tend to think there will be a turn in the equities sooner than people think. That group stopped trading coincidentally with day rates, traded coincidentally with day rates for about 10 years, which is not really the way stocks are supposed to work. And about 2 years ago, that relationship broke down, and the stocks and the asset values deteriorated. Despite the fact that rates were still very, very firm. That kind of leading indicator, that kind of relationship should also hold coming out of this cycle as well. So it might be one or two more tough prints in terms of tanker resales, but I think there could be a turn in tanker equities sometime in 17, if not 18, but I think it could be a bit sooner than most expect. I'll save dry bulk for my esteemed colleagues here. It's generally not one of my favorite spaces. And that has mostly to do with the investor universe and the fact that you really need a very long-term catalyst to attract institutional investors into dry bulk. Part of the issue is that the key holders on the street are generalists, right? So for tankers or for LNG or for LPG, it's an energy investor that's buying into the stock usually. They're going to understand the market and the dynamics on both sides of that supply chain. And it gives them a bit more security in terms of thinking about the thesis and holding it if, say, there's a bad quarter or two. For dry bulk, you're constantly dealing with generalists on both the entry point and generally exiting that trade as well. So it's just very difficult to get a lot of long-term momentum on the institutional side for dry bulk, unless you have a long-term demand catalyst, like we saw with China joining the WTO. Or perhaps the impact of environmental regulations in the next 2 to 3 years, which would be what we'd kind of look at. I didn't touch on everything, Nick, but containers as well. Actually, I think we're kind of bottoming out there a bit. We actually upgraded Costamare early in the week. It's obviously very early, and margins are still very, very tight, and we're still dealing with counterparty risk throughout the space, but that's typically when you want to step into equities like this. So as long as they've got dividend cuts and capital raises and debt restructuring behind them, we think they start to look interesting.
So I understand Herman has a different opinion.
I agree with a lot of the things that Mike said, but on your comment on dry bulk, I would say I disagree. I don't think it's hard to get long-term investors into the space, and I think as a general theme in shipping today, whether it's dry bulk, tankers, LNG, whatever it is, there's some very, very attractive features for the long-only investors. So just to to name some facts. The number of yards that delivered more than one ship in 2011, it peaked at 200 yards. Last year, 100 yards delivered more than one ship. Out of those 100 yards, 37 delivered more than five ships. If you look on the ordering side, last year, 27 yards received one new order. Out of those 27, only 7 yards received more than five new building orders. So I think what the long-term capital likes about the general shipping theme right now, and I definitely think there's been a very strong incremental change on that from only November until now, is the fact that you have an order book, which is coming down to a very low level at the same time as you have a situation at the yard, which looks very, very attractive. So take ordering a dry bulk ship today. I mean, if you pay $42 million for a Capesize ship, you lose $4 million day one when that ship is delivered. So no sane person would prefer to buy a new building for 42 when you can buy a secondhand for 38. So that's the, call it, the supply side of the equation. I think also what's definitely, I would say, new, I don't think we've experienced this in many, many years. If you look, whether you look at dry bulk, tankers, LNG, whatever it is, there's one common input factor to all of our models, and it's economic growth. So if you look at IMF over the last 5-6 years, every year they've said, this year is going to be challenging, but next year will be better. And then we get to next year, and they say, well, actually, it's not going to be good after all. It's going to be next year. That's happened 5-6 years in a row. Mm-hmm. Now, I think there's a real positive belief in economic growth actually picking up. And I think one of the important reasons for why economic growth has been disappointing is due to a continuous decline in commodity prices since 2011. The commodity boom peaked in 2011. And the boom from, you mentioned China becoming a member of WTO in December 2001, from 2011 until December 2015, the entire commodity boom that we experienced from 98 up until 2011 was wiped out, if you look at Bloomberg Commodity Index. So there's been some...
Herman, I'm sorry to interrupt. Since he's going to leave in a few minutes...
Sorry, Mike, I'll give you...
No.
I'm just saying that I think it's a really good time to be a bit forward-leaning and bullish.
I'm very impressed. If you have the stats memorized, I'm very impressed.
Yeah, well...
The three of us will have a discussion for some...
Yeah. And I wouldn't disagree with that at all. I would say that the... From an asset perspective, we certainly think dry bulk makes sense, right? So, but I guess the longer I've covered the equities... You know, I like to work backwards, basically. I like to figure out who my natural buyer is going to be when I look to exit the trade and work backwards from there. Because as you, I'm sure you all have personal accounts or trading accounts, there have been times where I'm sure you've gotten the idea behind a shipping stock just dead right, but the stock has not reacted the way you thought it would. At the end of the day, equities are effectively derivatives of the models that you got, the markets that you guys follow every day, the fundamental physical models, our markets. So I think with dry bulk, all I'm trying to say is that there's a bit of a higher hurdle in terms of bringing in institutional investors because that derivative of that physical market is just a bit more askew than I would say LNG or some other assets are. But I agree with everything you're saying.
Thank you.
Mike, can I also ask you, you cover... I mean, the other guys do too. You cover the MLP space.
Yes.
Do you see the MLP market coming back? Do you believe that the MLP is still a viable structure for shipping companies?
If anything, MLPs have the lowest cost of capital in shipping today. Those yields have been cut in half since early 16, most of 2015. So you've got the stronger players in the space that are now kind of pushing towards an 8% yield and narrowing. The question I think, Nick, is going to be where the new normal is. If I think about the last cycle, Gas Log Partners was generally at the lowest cost of capital on the street at about a sub 4% or around a 4-4.5% yield. I would imagine that if they're the benchmark and everyone else kind of fills out the curve behind them, that new normal is probably 100 to 150 basis points wider than it was before the crisis. But I certainly think we're heading that direction. If you look at even the last 3 to 6 months, we've seen Gas Log raise money twice. Herg did an equity raise not too long ago. I'm sure Knutson, I believe, did one as well. So you're starting to see the appetite for growth capital come back. And what's happening is, as traditional and larger MLPs have appreciated, we launched on Chenier last week. They've had a nice run, like Kinder Morgan and others. The marine MLPs have screened very well for value, right? So you see traditional MLP or yield investors stepping in, and they can buy, you know, Gas Log Partners or Teekay LNG at a 10 or 11% yield. And as those yields start to narrow, they'll look back and they'll look at Capital Product Partners or some of the bulk names. But no, the short answer is absolutely. I think that just about any other sector in shipping would kill to have the cost of capital that marine MLPs have right now, most of them anyway.
And the last question to ask before you go, and again, the three of us will have a discussion much longer. Do you expect more companies to come to the market, either for IPOs or secondary offerings?
That's a good question. Yes. I think that investors...
Is there a market for them?
Not right now, but I think that there's a very long line for companies that want to get out. I mean, there's a very well-known list of tanker names that have wanted to go public, and in other sectors as well. I would say that the idea that investors are willing to step into a niche name just because there isn't an LR operator in the market, or there isn't a liquid product tanker name besides Ardmore and Scorpio, I think that's a bit of a tougher sell right now. I would really look at the way crude tankers traded over the past 2 or 3 years. I think it's really indicative of what we're going to see going forward, that investors, it's not 2007, 2008, right? They looked at the story there, they looked at where rates were and where NAVs were, and we got to mid-cycle, and there was not a bid for those names, despite the fact that rates were really performing well. So I would be surprised if that theme and that pattern did not extend itself to the other sectors as they recover too. So maybe on the high spec LNG side, so on the regas side, on the carrier side maybe, and maybe another product tanker name. But I think you're more likely to see some of the names that are waiting to go public merge with smaller players that are public that are struggling for trading volume and or cap. So, but I'm sure you guys have thoughts that too. So it's a tough question to answer.
So Mike, maybe we can thank you very much. Mm-hmm. We'd love to keep you longer. I'd love to have dinner with you tonight, but you have how many more minutes?
3 minutes.
Okay. So maybe I can go to James.
I'll use him to listen to Herman's answer to that question, actually.
Oh, okay.
I have a lot of things that I would like to say before you leave. But I think one thing you touched upon, which is very interesting, is the, call it, historical unprecedented break between asset prices and rates that we saw in the tanker market. Mm-hmm. And to be frank, I mean, we were quite bullish on the tanker market a year ago. We definitely did not think that OPEC would change their strategy, but, you know, when variables change, they change their mind. That being said, it was a very strange situation where you had 10% of the VLCC fleet for sale in an environment where you were making $100,000 a day. I think in hindsight, at least what we think the mistake we did was we looked too much in tankers in isolation without acknowledging that ship owners tend to own, like Robert McLeod says, how do you recognize a VLCC owner? He also owns three Capes. And when your loan to value on your Capes went from 60 to 110% overnight, you frankly didn't have any choice. You had to sell your tankers. And I think that's why we had this unprecedented, call it, break between asset prices and rates, because it wasn't only dry bulk you were challenging. Mm-hmm. It was containers, it was LNG, it was rigs and supply vessels across the board. So I think, and obviously, we were banging our heads to the wall, but I think as a general theme, things are much better, positioned now due to the one very common thing. The supply side is coming down across the board, across all sectors. Fleet growth is slowing sharply, and it coincides with what seems to be finally growth actually fundamentally picking up. And I don't think that's actually due to Donald Trump or anything like that. It's the higher commodity prices boosting emerging market and commodity exporting economies.
Yeah.
So, but you know, before you leave, if you had $100 million, how would you spend it?
That's a good question. I'd try to roll up old LNG carriers. Actually, it's a market that doesn't clear. There's actually someone that's doing it. That's rolling up old Moss carriers. It's a really interesting trade. But no, I agree. I think it's just a question of whether or not the market. I tend to think the market was broken for the first 8 years the space was public, and now it's acting appropriately, right? Where, you know, a VLCC that runs $160 million, right? There are very few people in the room that would want to buy that, right? So just as, you know, your risk tolerance changes, right, as the market evolves, and maybe 110 for a VLCC doesn't look quite as attractive, the same thing applies to equities. I think as the irrational exuberance of the latter half of the last decade is firmly in the rearview mirror, I think there's just a more realistic band of where people think assets and equities should trade, and I think it's just an adjustment to that new normal. But I'd be very happy to be proven wrong about that if we go back to people, you know, to huge NAV multiples and asset values that move well beyond mid-cycle. But I tend to think that the equities looking ahead and starting to discount values beyond mid-cycle makes sense, and that's what happens in most sectors. So with that,
thank you,
thank
Mike.
You very much.
Thank you again
thank you
for
much.
Making the long trip, and have a safe flight. And James, now we come to you. So, you know, where do you stand in terms of sectors, your likes, dislikes?
Well, I can't.
I think you have. You're on. You're on.
Okay. So I've been launched on dry box. I can't talk in too detail. But based on the last conversation on whether trading liquidity is and where the investors are, we've actually seen an uptick of new investors looking to get into shipping. I think what happened in the past was there wasn't a real long-term recovery in shipping in the shipping sector. It was blips here and there. Rates were up for about 6 months and they would drop. Same thing with asset values. And there were a lot of institutional investors that saw that and said, you know, I don't know how to play this. I got in at an X price. I can't exit now. I'll just hold it for now. But what we're seeing is new investors who understand this story, all the macroeconomic forces beyond shipping. So I think what's interesting now is there's a real structural change coming to the sector. If you look prior to, you know, the single hull to the double hull change, with the new ballast water treatment systems coming into effect and the NOx scrubbers coming into effect, that's going to force a lot of older tonnage to get out of the market, and that's going to alleviate supply. And we all know about the liquidity crunch and the shipyard capacity constraints. And all those factors tied together, I think it's going to help all sectors of shipping for a prolonged period of time. I would say I'm very bullish on shipping for the next at least 2 years. I don't want to look too far out because we don't know when new ordering is going to, you know, build up again, and you know, maybe in 2017, 2018, ship owners say, "Hey, this is when we're going to order," and then 19 and 20, the market crashes again. But if you look at the order book now, if you look at, you know, especially on the tanker side with crude production, so the Saudi cuts, great, you know, it's not great news for the sector, but that's not the most important feature, I think. I think we need to look at ton-mile demand and the dislocation of cargoes now. And with the Trump administration coming into effect and his policies against certain South American countries, specifically Mexico, you're going to see, I believe you're going to see a lot more crude trade from Mexico going to Western India and the Far East and also Northern Europe, which is way better in terms of ton-miles versus going to the West Coast of California. So I think all these factors together, it's going to make 17 a little volatile while we get to a new normal and new trade flows, persist. And then in 18 and 19, we'll see, the start of mid-cycle rates.
Yeah, I mean, I think, on the, you know, if you look at the oil tankers, I think it's actually need to start ordering some ships in not too many years, because the order book in take on the product side is 1% net fleet growth in 2019.
Yeah.
I think there's some very interesting, call it long-term dynamics that you kind of alluded to. If you look at oil consumption per capita, the Chinese consumption is one-third of European average consumption per capita, and compared to the US is one-seventh. Their domestic production has been flat over the last 10 years and started declining over the last year or so. So there's definitely some very, you know, top-down positive drivers on the tanker market in terms of ton-mile or longer hauls. The other interesting thing, and I agree with you, the OPEC decision or the Saudi decision, which I guess is more exactly, correct yeah. way to say it, as you said, it's interesting because something very important happened a few years back when the US lifted the export ban on crude. What that meant is that the consequence of Saudi or OPEC, call it cutting or increasing production, is less, call it severe for the tanker market outside of, call it the short-term adjustment of global inventories. Because if the outcome of this is that post-inventory, call it normalization, which, you know, OPEC has said straight out, we want to get the global oil inventories down to the five-year average. And what happens after that, whether it's US production who ramps up and starts to export, or whether it's Saudi or OPEC in general that ramps up production, it doesn't really matter. So it's rather than call it the contrast was up until the ban was lifted, what happened was that higher, the US crude was landlocked, so the growth in oil demand did not hit the global tanker fleet. So, I mean, I think the tanker market definitely has a good legs, and I agree with Mike, who said before he left that you're going to buy tankers during 2017. And frankly, you have one of the best tanker owners in the world, John Fredriksen, who's clearly said that this is the right time to start buying assets through his offer on DHT. And also when it comes to dry bulk, and there's one kind of common thing which I think is a bit interesting. People talk about oversupply of ships and so on. I think what really, and I need to stress this, you know, I was in New York 2 weeks back, and for the first time in 5 years, I had more meetings with long-only guys than hedge fund guys. And that's really long-term money coming into the shipping space. And they don't really care about the NAV and so on. They care about an optionality, a long-term optionality on the market. And to, you know, the oversupply and these things that we throw out left, right, and center, in a way, like, it depends on the price you pay. That's the really interesting, I think it was one of the Movinkel from earlier on said today that there is a value in dry bulk and tankers and so on. I thought that was a very interesting comment because there is incredible value across the shipping space due to the deflationary pressure we've had on asset prices today. Take, you know, if you buy a 10-year-old Cape today at around $15 million, the last time a 10-year-old Cape cost $15 million, you have to go back to the early 80s on a nominal basis. And if you adjust for the fact that in the 80s, Cape was 135, around $180,000 a day, deadweight tons, then it's never, ever been as cheap as it is today. And what that means is obviously that the rates you need to create a positive return are way below whatever historical market you've seen. I mean, $15 million to make a 10% unlevered return, you need $10,500. The 20-year average rate is 32 or something. So it's, and that's the really interesting thing is that the first leg of this recovery, which I am very confident will that we are materializing, it's not actually something happening in the future. It's already started. The 10-year Panamax, as an example, has moved up $1.5 million in a few months. So, but the interesting thing is that the first part of this recovery is actually just getting values back to a level that call it reflects the long-term required asset values in terms of renewing the fleet. So I think definitely tankers are interesting right now. I would say definitely dry bulk offers a very, very interesting risk reward.
What about the product tanker side?
I think that's also, I mean, do you want to answer that?
Yeah, I mean, so like I said, I'm a bull. So same thing with product tankers. If you look at refinery capacity in the US, And with the U.S. export, they've been a net exporter since, I believe, 2005. That's going to continue, especially with Trump's policies and what's going on with the production of U.S. shale. And then another interesting thing is, like I said, with the policies in place with Trump, I think you're going to see a new triangulation route, especially in the Atlantic Basin, with, you know, with the U.S. products, they're going down to South America and, you know, possibly Africa. And same thing with the European products going down to South America and Africa without, you know, and you might see some trade still with the U.S. and Northern Europe. But I think in terms of ton mile and demand, it's going to be great on the Atlantic Basin. And with the new refinery capacities coming online east of the Suez, I think that's going to be a boom. The Chinese are definitely going to pull in a lot more products. The Chinese middle class is growing, that's a fact. And the first thing, you know, there are two things that a growing middle class do. They eat more food and they drive more. And the Chinese are purchasing more cars. And an important note is they're purchasing larger vehicles now. So their demand is going to grow exponentially, I believe. And I think that's going to definitely help with the MR demand, especially on the product side, for at least the next 2-3 years, based on what the order book is.
Well, if I can take the discussion to a little bit of a different direction, both of your firms have been very active in capital raising. I heard Herman saying that he met long-only guys now. So my question is twofold. Number one, do you see new money, new people coming into shipping? And then the second question is, Maxim, you've been very very successful raising money for mid-sized companies, which I think is very important. You have tended to focus more, I think, on the bigger names. So do we see an investor base that is interested in each market cap? Because one of the things we talk about shipping is we need size, we need liquidity, definitely it's good. But on the other hand, you have a number of smaller, medium-sized companies of very good quality. And what is the future for them in the capital markets? I think Maxim has proved that there is a future. So I wanted to hear the commentary of both of you from your own point of view. We also see now Frontline and DHT. They're trying to create a mega company in the crude oil space. So how do you see the market evolving?
I also heard some comments earlier on about should they be diversified appropriately or so on. I think, and I wanted to make the comment on that panel that you have a very good example of Maersk. It's a multi-billion-dollar company with lots and lots of trading liquidity, and it's constantly trading at a discount to the sum of the parts because of the conglomerate discount. So it's, I think there's room for all types of companies, small or large. The interesting thing is as well, if you look on, just take the dry bulk as an example, the daily traded value in globally listed dry bulk names in 2007 was between $1 and $1.5 billion traded every single day in globally listed shares. That fell down to about $37 million traded every day, more or less this time last year. And since then, it's up 6.5 times. So there's definitely a lot more liquidity in the shipping space today than it was a year ago. And I think to your question is, do you see new investors coming in? For sure. I think there's both more retail and also more long-only investors coming in. So I think that's a reflection of the risk reward. Mr. Market is very efficient, I think. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I've only been at Maxim since the end of August. And since then, we've had calls from new investors looking at shipping firms. I think definitely the mid-cap space, there's a lot of funds still active. And I think there were a lot of investors that got burnt the first time around on the shipping side. And now they realize, okay, they know how to play the sector and the cycle. And the ones that are left that are willing to invest in shipping, I think they look at where we are now in the cycle. And just like ship owners are trying to time it, and they're trying to get in now. We've seen a lot of new activity from new accounts. And so I definitely think in the small to mid-cap space, shipping can survive.
So do you see a different type of investors investing in the different market capitalization companies?
think that's a hard question to answer.
Yeah,
really.
I mean,
I think definitely the large institutional investors, they actually seem to be more focused on the strategy of the company and the setup rather than necessarily the size. And I think, as my colleague Carl mentioned earlier today, we raised, since November, $174 million for Stronger Bulk, which didn't exist 5 months ago. So that's, I think it's throughout the cycle, in any sector, there's always available capital, but it obviously it, sometimes it's more painful than others to take that capital. So, but there's space for both small and large and diversified and not diversified companies.
Well, to ask a different question, by the way, I presume that retail is playing a bigger role now in the overall transaction volume and the shareholding base of companies in the U.S. Do you see that?
I actually don't. I haven't seen any statistics on it. But I mean, we obviously focus on being a boutique investment bank in the larger financial markets. We focus on the larger companies, and but there's definitely retail. It's been retail actually throughout. So
the cycle, yeah.
Yeah.
One of the questions I'd like to ask both of you is, I hear a lot of arguments, especially from the owner side, that NAV, for example, should not be a metric. Because NAV, tends to look at people to buy things at discount, and they not to look at the quality of the company, the cash flow coming in, and so on. So what do you think about that?
Well, I mean, I think NAV is a good metric, depending on where you are in the cycle. When you're at the peak, it's probably not the best metric to use. When you're in the trial, entering into an expansion, that's probably a good barometer of where the asset, where the company's value should be in a 12-month or 24-month period. I know there are some ship owners who don't believe NAV is a good metric, but at the end of the day, when they liquidate their assets, that's what's going to come into play. So I think it's important.
So since it's a panel debate, I'll take the opposite position. I think you kind of alluded to it. It's a very, very dangerous strategy to always try to buy below NAV and sell above NAV, because typically what you see is that the capital market is quite efficient. And for example, right now, you have lots of listed dry book names trading above NAV. And it's a reflection of the financial markets predicting higher asset prices. So if you always sell when things are trading above NAV and you always buy when it's trading below, then frankly what you're doing is selling in the market going up and buying in the market going down. And that's the famous Keynes quote, the market can be irrational for longer than you can be solvent. And I think NAV is one of many ways to look at the bet that you're taking, but it doesn't really tell you anything about the NAV changes over time as asset prices change. And I think actually a much better metric is to look at enterprise value over assets or EV assets, because that tells you when you buy a certain name, how much higher asset prices are actually priced into buying the stock at a certain price. And then obviously for some of the audience here, you have the luxury to actually buy the ship itself rather than buy the publicly listed stocks. So. I think, NAV just tells you how far off is the financial market relative to the asset market. But to use that as a sole reason to conclude on whether buy or sell, I think it's doesn't really tell you the whole picture.
So to ask, maybe I can ask James and come back to you. If I'm an investor and I have X amount of money, do I buy stocks or do I buy assets? If I want to have exposure in shipping.
Well, if you're an institutional investor, I would recommend you buy stocks and not a ship. But it depends on the sector. So I agree with Herman. If you look at dry bulk and everything's kind of trading above NAV, but it's also, well, where do you think the cycle is going to go and how long is it going to last? And will at a certain point in time, is that going to actually be trading below NAV, right, or above NAV? On the tanker side, if you see what John Fredericks is doing, he's seeing. He knows DHT's value. He knows they're trading under NAV, and that's why he's trying to do a stock offer for them. So I think it's not an easy question to answer.
I know. Yeah. So, Herman, if I can ask you, if I am a company and I have excess cash,
in today's market, should I be using my cash to pay a dividend, or should I use my cash to grow and take advantage of market opportunities?
I think on Monday, Scorpio Tankers cut their dividends from 12.5 to 1 cent, and the stock price was up 14%. The dividend is, at the end of the day, a reflection of the return on capital. You can try to fool the market by returning capital rather than call it return on capital. But obviously, you see some names like NIT, which have been able to create superior currency in the public market by consistently paying a dividend over 60 or 70 quarters. But personally, I would rather invest into assets today than to pay a dividend on some assets, which, frankly, I mean, dry bulk, you can... I think everyone understands that that dividend isn't reoccurring at the current rate environment.
Well, we have a few minutes left. I don't know if there are any questions from the floor that we can address to our analysts. I think we got everybody very well informed.
Everyone know everything. That's good.
So I don't know if you would like to give a concluding remark before we call it a day.
I would say... earlier on, there was some talk of constrained optimism, and also one of my fellow Norwegian said that it's important to have fun rather than complain. I think the opportunity in shipping today is extremely good, in particular on the dry side. At some point, you definitely need to look more into the tankers as well. And LNG, and kind of that's a completely different discussion, but gas as a part of the energy mix is definitely been the winner for the last 20 years and will probably be for the next 20 as well, so that's also very interesting. But I would say, as a concluding remark, I would say this is the time to take risk and be forward-leaning rather than being defensive.
For me, I know we touched on all the sectors except LPG, and I just have to say I'm a big LPG bull. If you look at the production coming online, especially in the U.S., I think with what the current order book looks, especially on the handy-sized LPG sector, there's going to be a boom in ethane and ethylene and butadiene exports into China, which is great because China's going to build out, I believe, 11 PDH plants with probably 2.8 billion tons capacity by 2018, 2019. And most of that is going to come from the U.S. and in the long-haul trade. And with the current capacity constraints at the shipyards, I think LPG is going to be a growing segment.
Well, I'd like to thank you all very much. You can ask a question, but you are between us and the drinks.
Well, I don't cover containers right now, so I can't speak too much, but if you look, it's massively oversupplied. I don't think anybody's going to argue that fact. They talked about 7 million TEUs being scrapped last year, but still the market's oversupplied. And I think unless there's more scrapping of the Panamax vessels, because all the post-Panamaxes that were ordered to replace the Panamaxes, that didn't happen until those Panamaxes go away, I think the market's going to be a little constrained.
I think the interesting thing about the container market is that on the demand side, historically, if you go back to the 80s, the demand for container ships versus GDP was a 3x multiplier, and the multiplier to the GDP number has been falling from 3 to less than 1 last year. And I think it was at this panel last year where one of my research colleagues claim that we reached peak stuff and, you know, we in the Western world have what we need and so on. I don't think that's the reason. I think the reason why that multiplier has been falling is because what's been driving economic growth in recent times is emerging markets and call it countries closer to the source of export, which is China. And, you know, if you look at volumes, even though Europe is small in on a relative basis in volume, not small, but it's not the largest, in TU miles, they're very big. So they're actually the largest demand driver in TU mile terms. which means that in a sense you have the container market is obviously bet really on economic growth in Europe to really, that's where you have the big delta. So I mean, hopefully we'll do better here in Europe in the future, but it looks very interesting from the perspective of where the order book are and expectations on demand and so on. It's a bit less comfortable in terms of the residual risk on call it new versus old ships, and then the consolidation of the operators, which means that they have even stronger hand on the asset providers today than they did just a few years ago due to the merger of multiple companies. So I think from a risk reward perspective, it's less attractive than the dry side or the containers or the LNG, but definitely very interesting.
Thank you very much. And I think, great guys, thank you so much for a wonderful discussion. And thank you to all of you for being with us.